the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our help is in the name of the Lord.
Who made heaven and earth.
If you, O Lord, kept a record of sins, O Lord, who could stand?
What could you do to bear his forgiveness? Therefore you are feared.
Since we are gathered to hear God's word, call upon him in prayer and praise, and receive the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ and the fellowship of this altar, let us first consider our unworthiness and confess before God and one another that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and that we cannot free ourselves from our sinful condition. Together as his people, let us take refuge in the infinite mercy of God, our Heavenly Father, seeking his grace for the sake of Christ and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Almighty God, have mercy upon us, forgive us our sins, and lead us to everlasting life. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
My heart shall rejoice in your
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, the strength of all who trust in you, mercifully accept our prayers. And because through the weakness of our mortal nature we can do no good thing, grant us your grace to keep your commandments, that we may please you in both will and deed. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
The Old Testament reading for the first Sunday after Trinity is from Genesis chapter 15. After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Fear not, Abram, I am your shield. Your reward shall be very great. But Abram said, O Lord God, what will you give me? For I continue childless, and the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus. And Abram said, Behold, you have given me no offspring, and a member of my household will be my heir. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him. This man shall not be your heir. Your very own son shall be your heir. And he brought him outside and said, Look toward heaven and number the stars, if you are able to number them. Then he said to him, So shall your offspring be. And he believed the Lord, and he counted it to him as righteousness. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I said, O Lord, be gracious to me. Heal me, for I have sinned against you. Blessed is the one who considers the poor. In the day of trouble, the Lord delivers him.
The epistle is from 1 John chapter 4. So we have come to know and to believe the love that God has for us. God is love, and whoever abides in love abides in God, and God abides in him. By this is love perfected with us, so that we may have confidence for the day of judgment, because as he is, so also are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. For fear has to do with punishment, and whoever fears has not been perfected in love. We love because he first loved us. If anyone says, I love God, and hates his brother, he is a liar. For he who does not love his brother whom he has seen cannot love God whom he has not seen. And this commandment we have from him, whoever loves God must also love his brother. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We stand for the Alleluia. Alleluia. The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 16th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said, There was a rich man who was clothed in purple and fine linen, and who feasted sumptuously every day. And at his gate was laid a poor man named Lazarus, covered with sores, who desired to be fed with what fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, even the dogs came and licked his sores. The poor man died and was carried by the angels to Abraham's side. The rich man also died and was buried, and in Hades, being in torment, he lifted up his eyes and saw Abraham far off and Lazarus at his side. And he called out, "Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus to dip the end of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am in anguish in this flame." But Abraham said, "Child, remember that you in your lifetime received your good things, and Lazarus in like manner bad things. But now he is comforted here, and you are in anguish. And besides all this, between us and you a great chasm has been fixed, in order that those who would pass from here to you may not be able, and none may cross from there to us." And he said, "Then I beg you, Father, to send him to my father's house, for I have 5 brothers, so that he may warn them, lest they also come into this place of torment." But Abraham said, "They have Moses and the prophets. Let them hear them." And he said, "No, Father Abraham, but if someone goes to them from the dead, they will repent." He said to him, "If they do not hear Moses and the prophets, neither will they be convinced if someone should rise from the dead." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
I believe in one God,
the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for
the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Faith, we know, comes from hearing the word of Christ. And faith that hears the word of Christ will always grab hold of and hang on to and trust that word of Christ. Because that's what faith is. It is trust of God based on his own word. God said it, so it must be true. This is the way of faith. And the way of faith is the way of righteousness. Now, not a worldly righteousness, mind you, the kind that looks at the sinful actions of those around you to puff yourself up, the sort of righteousness that delights in the failures of others, the sort of righteousness that is achieved through obedience to the law and being a good neighbor, mowing your lawn, paying your taxes, using your turning signal, and being polite to your fellow shoppers at Kroger. No, the righteousness of faith, the righteousness that is reckoned to you on account of your trust of God based on the word of God, is not a worldly sort of righteousness that gives you a reason to boast in yourself, but rather, it is the sort of righteousness that gives you innocence before God in heaven. The sort of righteousness that calms the fearing conscience because it means that the Lord will not be judging you according to your sin. The righteousness of faith, the righteousness that trusts God because of what God has said, is the righteousness that is necessary to be justified before God and receive eternal life. So if this sort of righteousness is the result of faith, and faith only comes from hearing, then it follows that the righteousness of faith is only had by those who have heard the word of God and believed the word of God to be true. Faith, after all, comes from hearing. And so we see Abram. Already, as it is recorded in Genesis chapter 12, the Lord had called Abram. 3 chapters prior to our Old Testament reading, the Lord had come down to Abram from heaven and given Abram a word. The Lord was going to make of Abram an exceedingly great nation. The Lord was going to make Abram's name great. And whoever Abram would bless, the Lord also would bless. This was the word of the Lord which had already been given to Abram for him to hear and to trust, because this was the word that had been given to him from the Lord. But only 3 chapters later, in our Old Testament reading, we see Abram not trusting the word which the Lord himself had spoken. In fact, what we see looks a lot like a man who assumes that the Lord has reneged on his promise, or has forgotten about it altogether. And yet, the Lord is gracious to come down to Abram once again from heaven to comfort him with an additional word and promise of hope. Fear not, Abram. I am your shield. Your reward shall be very great. And the reward, of course, to which the Lord was referring was the reward which he himself had already promised Abram. A child. Because you see, if Abram had been promised to be the father of a great nation, there must be a child. And that child and the offspring that would come after him is the promise given to Abram in the Lord's first call. And it's the promise the Lord reiterates in chapter 15 when he refers to Abram's reward, which the Lord reminds him will be very great. The Lord had come down from heaven not once, but here he has come to Abram a second time because Abram has forgotten the promise. And by not clinging to the promise, Abram's trust in the Lord has faltered. He doesn't think he's going to have a son. He doesn't think that the Lord will keep his promise. He doesn't believe. His faith has faltered. And we even hear him telling the Lord just how certain of it he is. Oh, Lord God, what will you give me? For I continue childless, and the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus, who's not even my son. Behold, you have given me no offspring, and a member of my household has to be my heir. Can you hear the distrust in his voice? He doesn't believe the word which the Lord had given to him. And so, as a result, he does not trust the Lord. In fact, he's angry at the Lord. For it isn't that he has forgotten the promise altogether, but he has concluded that the promise won't be kept. And what good is a God who doesn't keep his promises? It almost sounds like a righteous sort of anger. Except that there is nothing righteous about it. For it only flows from unbelief. He is unrighteous in his anger toward the Lord, for his anger is only there because he does not trust and cling to and believe that the Lord who gave him a promise will keep the promise. Repent. Repent, dear people of God. Repent, you to whom the Lord has chosen to call and gather by the gospel, to whom the Lord has given his word and promise, to whom week after week the Lord has given you grace upon grace and the word of holy absolution, you who have the Lord God himself promise you that you will not die but will live eternally with him, that you are loved of God and have no reason to fear, you who have the Lord put his name upon you in holy baptism to mark you as his own children, who he promises to feed forever as his own children, to whom the Lord has promised every good gift of body and soul to be provided. Repent, dear people of God. For like Abram, you too have disbelieved the word and promise which the Lord himself has given to you. And so you have not trusted in God above all things. Now, this is not to say that you have necessarily fallen from the faith completely, although that certainly can happen if faith is completely snuffed out. But this is to say that even in the Christian, even in those like Abram who have been called by the Lord to be his people and been given a word of promise in which to trust, there remains the disbelief and doubt of the flesh. And so, like Abram, when you can't see how the Lord will work to keep his promise, you sometimes conclude that he won't, and that his promise may not have been a promise in the first place. And then you become fearful, or angry, or you become ashamed or guilty, or you justify your staying away from the house of God because, in fact, God, you think, is at fault for all the pain and sorrow that you are facing. And you end up just like Abram. Or at least there is this part of you that does. For there is this part of you, even for the Christian, which does not trust God because it refuses to believe that God will be faithful and will keep his promise no matter what. It's that which we must repent of. For that is unbelief. And unbelief is not righteous. And if it is allowed to remain and to fester and to grow, even if it starts out innocent, a small doubt or a little anger, that small doubt or that little anger will grow and fester and remain until finally the anger and the fear and the doubt have taken over completely, and there is no longer any faith whatsoever. And so we all must repent of the unbelief which remains in our old Adam. And we must not allow it to exist. We must crucify it daily when it arises within. And that little voice of doubt which wants you to think that God is no better at keeping his promises than any of us, that little voice must be silenced, for the liar that he is, so that faith would not be destroyed and the righteousness that justifies us before God in heaven be lost forever. But with repentance, there must once again be a promise, a word by which faith will be given and strengthened and sustained in the place of fear and doubt and anger and despair. It is not enough simply to acknowledge the sin of doubt and unbelief, but what is also necessary where the sin of doubt and unbelief have existed is to hear once again the promise of God by which the Lord himself has called us and given us faith in the first place. For where there is repentance, you see, there is also the forgiveness of sins. There is a word, and that word is there to be trusted. And so once again, we have faith coming through hearing the word of God. And this faith ends up being reckoned as that by which we are declared once again to be righteous before God. Notice, of course, what happened when Abram spoke from his doubting, fearful, angry, and unbelieving flesh. The Lord, like a loving father who is willing to hear his children complain in their youthful ignorance, but knows all along, in fact, that the sky is not falling, nor the world coming to an end, the Lord takes angry Abram outside. And he points him to the skies, and then he does what every faithful preacher called to deliver the gospel to doubting, fearful, angry, and unbelieving sinners is called to do. He reiterates the word of promise. For the word of promise was that which was there and remained there to be trusted all the time. Abram, oh, Abram, you can almost hear the Lord saying, this man, Eliezer of Damascus, shall not be your heir. Your own son shall be your heir. For that's what I promised. And in Hebrew, it's just beautiful. To Abram, who does not trust that the Lord will give him a child of his own, the Lord says literally, he who will come from your own belly, he himself will inherit you. It was the very same promise which the Lord had given him when he had first called him. But sinful, doubting, angry, unbelieving Abram needed to hear it again. And when he heard it, The word of the Lord was powerful to produce in Abram the faith which once again trusted in the Lord. Faith had come once again from hearing. And so through faith, which was clinging once again to that word of promise, the Lord credits Abram with righteousness. The righteousness before God, by which a sinner is justified and declared innocent, and so will receive eternal life. Dear people of God, you are freely justified, declared innocent before God for the sake of Christ, whose death has atoned for all the world's sin. It is that word which you have to cling to. And the Lord who gives you that word is faithful. He does not lie. If he says your sins are forgiven, then your sins are forgiven. If he says that he will give you life for the sake of Christ, then for the sake of Christ, he will give you life. If he, as your Father, promises to be your shield and to guard and protect you from all evil, then you can be certain that you will be guarded and protected from all evil, for he, your Father, will be your shield. Doubt and fear and anger are the result of the word of God being forgotten or rejected or just not being believed. And the word of the Lord not being believed produces unrighteousness and only has one end: to be cut off from God, to live forever in anguish in the flames of hell. That was the rich man in the parable. And to this desperate plea that someone go and warn his brothers, those five brothers that were still alive, so that they might be spared the same hellish fate, do you remember how Father Abraham responded? Well, he responded based upon what he had learned. That if they were already refusing to hear the word of the Lord, then in fact, there was nothing else that could be done for them. For the word of the Lord is the very thing that is necessary to be heard in order to join Abraham in the number of those who have the righteousness of faith. But you don't only have Moses and the prophets. You have Moses and the prophets and Jesus and the apostles. And all of them are clear in one certain promise. Jesus died to atone for your sins. He was raised for your justification. He is the shield which protects you from sin and death, and in him your reward will be exceedingly great. It will be eternal life, and that is a promise you can trust, for it is the promise of God. In the name of Jesus, amen. And now may the peace of God that transcends all our understanding guard your hearts and your minds through faith in Christ Jesus to life everlasting. Amen. We stand for prayer. Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Holy Father, you have had mercy on the children of man, sparing us from everlasting death in the blood and righteousness of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Hear us now as we confidently lay before your throne of grace our petitions for help and aid. Lord, in your mercy. Merciful Lord, for the benefit of your people, you call faithful men and women to serve in a variety of offices in your church. We thank you especially for the office of preaching the gospel and administering the sacrament. Bless the pastors of our synod, especially those who are set in authority, even Matthew, our synod president, Roger, our district president, and Mark, our circuit visitor. Raise up men and women to work in your vineyard according to your gracious will. Lord, in your mercy. Eternal Lord, ruler of all, graciously regard those who have been set in positions of authority among us, especially the President of the United States, the Governor of this state, and all legislators and magistrates. Grant that, guided by your Spirit, they may be high in purpose, wise in counsel, firm in good resolution and unwavering in duty, that under them we may be quiet and peaceably governed. This weekend, we especially ask that we would be ever mindful of those who have sacrificed their lives to protect and preserve the freedoms enjoyed in our land. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord God, we thank you that you have taught us what you would have us believe and do. Help us by your Holy Spirit, for the sake of Jesus Christ, to hold fast to your word in our hearts, which you have cleansed, that thereby we may be made strong in faith and perfect in holiness, and be comforted in life and death. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty God, our heavenly Father, because of your tender love toward us sinners, you have given us your Son, that believing in him we might have everlasting life. Continue to grant us your Holy Spirit, that we may remain steadfast in this faith to the end, and finally come to everlasting life. Lord, in your mercy. Loving Father, hear our prayers on behalf of your servants David, Elmer, Patricia, Lou, Mary Jane, Joshua, Norma, Ron, Alan, Zalia, and all who are sick, homebound, and lonely. Bless them with faith in your loving kindness and protection. Relieve their pain, guard them from all danger, restore to them the joy of your salvation, and uphold them with your tender hand. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear
our prayer. Merciful Father, today your Son, Jesus Christ, refreshes us with the gift of his true body and true blood in this Holy Supper. Bless our participation in these holy gifts with peace and joy in the knowledge that we are reconciled to you. Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Thank you. We stand. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Everlasting God, for the countless blessings you so freely bestow on us and all creation. Above all, we give thanks for your boundless love shown to us when you sent your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, into our flesh and laid on him our sin, giving him into death that we might not die eternally. Because he is now risen from the dead and lives and reigns to all eternity, all who believe in him will overcome sin and death and will rise again to new life. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying,
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of Sabaoth adored, heaven and earth with full acclaim, shout the glory of your name. Sing Hosanna in the highest, sing Hosanna to the Lord. Truly blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of all creation, for you have had mercy on us and given your only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. In your righteous judgment, you condemned the sin of Adam and Eve, who ate the forbidden fruit, and you justly barred them and all their children from the tree of life. Yet in your great mercy, you promised salvation by a second Adam, your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, and made his cross a life-giving tree for all who trust in him. We give you thanks for the redemption you have prepared for us through Jesus Christ. Grant us your Holy Spirit, that we may faithfully eat and drink of the fruits of his cross and receive the blessings of forgiveness, life, and salvation that come to us in his body and blood. Hear us as we pray in his name and as he has taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it, and gave it to the disciples, and said, Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. In the same way also he took the cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
Jesus Christ, Christ,
Thank you.
us pray. Gracious God, our Heavenly Father, you have given us a foretaste of the feast to come and the Holy Supper of your Son's body and blood. Keep us firm in the true faith throughout our days of pilgrimage, that on the day of his coming we may together with all your saints celebrate the marriage feast of the Lamb and his kingdom, which has no end. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
Amen.